So what is insulin and why do we need to know about it? Insulin is a peptide hormone that is released from the beta cells of the pancreas or the islet of Langerhans. And insulin is released in response to a meal. So meal usually causes a spike in the blood glucose. And in response to a spike in blood glucose, insulin's job is to store this glucose in the form of energy, either in the form of glycogen or in the form of fat in the body for usage at a time when the body requires the energy. Now, it's important to realize that our lifestyle, our food habits, and the availability of food has changed over the last few decades, and that food has become far more easily available, it has become more refined, and our lives have become less active and more sedentary. As a result of this, since our bodies are exposed to a lot of glycogen or glucose overload, the way the body handles glucose is also important to understand. So once glucose enters the system, in response to that, there is a release of insulin. And insulin's job is to drive the glucose into the muscles where it is stored as glycogen. Now, glucose cannot enter the muscles without the presence of insulin, except in certain conditions, which I'll come to a bit later. Once insulin is available, the insulin acts on something known as the insulin receptor, which is similar to a car parking in a parking spot. Once insulin binds to the receptor, it triggers off a cascade of enzymatic events in the muscle cell. And then this causes something known as a glucose transporter or a GLUT4 transporter to come to the surface of the muscle cell. And then this creates a gate for glucose to enter into the muscle cell. And further on in the muscle, glucose can either be used as energy immediately or it can be stored as glycogen for future use. So the problem with the diets and our lifestyle right now is that our bodies are exposed to a lot of insulin. Because of the high glucose load, the pancreas has to work harder and harder to drive that glucose into the muscle. So over a period of many years, the exposure to a lot of insulin over many meals, many years, causes what is called insulin resistance. And that is because there are certain fatty acids known as diacylglycerols which get produced, and these cause a block in the cascade. So this means that when the insulin attaches to the receptor or the parking spot, the glucose enters the cell but does not get converted into glycogen, and the amount of glucose that's entering the cell gradually reduces over a period of time. So what happens is that the glucose stays in the blood, and that leads to a condition of high blood glucose, which we all know as diabetes mellitus. Now, there are two types of diabetes mellitus. Type 1, which is usually seen in the younger population, and that is for a totally different reason, where the pancreas beta cells are damaged, either because of infection or because of autoimmune antibodies. This, what I'm describing right now, is what we see usually in later life, usually in the sedentary population, and usually in people who do not exercise enough. And this is known as type 2 diabetes mellitus, which has far more health implications and is very important for us to learn about. So what happens when glucose does not enter the cell, the muscle cell? There is various problems that can take place. So there is an inflammatory response. There is acceleration of cardiovascular disease and atherosclerosis. There is reduced burning of fat or reduced lipolysis. There is accumulation of triglycerides inside the muscle. There's an increase in the lipids. There's an increase in the blood pressure. And we call all of that as metabolic syndrome. And this is one of the primary problems that we're facing, the health problems that doctors and health experts are facing across the globe in view of the change in human lifestyle. Another very, very important part of this whole syndrome of insulin resistance is the effect of insulin resistance on the liver. Now, the liver can take up glucose without the presence of insulin. So it's a glucose, insulin independent glucose uptake. However, the liver's ability to store glycogen is much smaller than the ability of muscle cells to store glycogen. Also, the fact that insulin resistance has occurred causes fat to accumulate in the liver. And this is something that we call fatty liver. It's also known as non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, or NAFLD, which is one of the biggest health concerns that Western countries are beginning to face. If left unchecked, and this accumulation of fat, if it continues to increase in the liver, it can lead to a condition known as NASH, which is non-alcoholic steatotic hepatitis, which is an inflammation of the liver as a result of this abnormal accumulation of fat. And this can eventually end up in cirrhosis and liver failure, which will require a liver transplant. So insulin resistance is a very, very key metabolic determinant of all these problems, whether it starts with high blood pressure, high blood sugar, abnormal deposition of fat around the midsection, abnormal lipids, non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, NASH, and cirrhosis. So please be aware of the effects of insulin, and please realize that by the time anyone develops diabetes, it's already too late to prevent these from happening. Insulin resistance is something that needs to be detected well before the onset of diabetes, so that we can bring in certain dietary and lifestyle changes which can delay or even prevent the development of diabetes. One of the most important things that one can do to prevent the development of insulin resistance is exercise. You've all heard me say on this channel before that exercise is medicine, and it is no truer than in this case. So it's been proven by various researchers who've spent a lifetime of their work studying insulin and insulin resistance that there is a way that muscles can take up glucose. And how this happens is through exercise. So like I mentioned to you about the GLUT4 transporter that comes to the surface of the muscle cell when the insulin receptor is activated by insulin, exercise can also bring up this transporter to the surface of the muscle cell and allow the muscle to take up glucose and convert it into glycogen. And one of the ways that this can be done is just by doing 45 minutes of zone 2 exercise. There's a very interesting study in the New England Journal of Medicine that shows that insulin sensitivity is vastly improved by just a 45 minute bout of zone 2 exercise. So it really doesn't take a lot for us to understand how important exercise is and to adopt this as part of our busy lives. So how does one know if you're insulin resistant or not? Unfortunately, there are no easy ways, but a very simple way that you can begin to understand the effect of insulin on your body is to do what is called a glycosylated hemoglobin, which we commonly call an HbA1c test. Now, this gives you a 3-month average of your blood sugar. Ideally, your mean blood sugar should be less than 120 milligrams per deciliter over 3 months. The other way is to check your fasting insulin levels, but these are very rough indicators of the status of insulin resistance in your body. The ideal way would be to do something known as a glucose tolerance test, which is a bit laborious because it means that you have to stay in the lab for about 90 to 120 minutes, and you have to have repeated blood samples of your blood glucose and your insulin levels in the blood, and then you plot a graph of your insulin versus your glucose. So it tells you the way that your body is handling glucose in response to a glucose load and how your insulin is handling that glucose load, whether it's spiking too high or it's in the normal range or it's optimal. And this is what will really tell you how insulin resistant you are. So if you watched all this information till the very end, thanks for sticking around and listening to this very important message. For more information, do follow me on YouTube and click here to follow me on Instagram.